Good morning, everybody. My name is Nasser Khatam Barre, and today I will present you a presentation about William Butler Yeats and his poem, An Irish Airman Foresees His Death. In this presentation, I will discuss 4 points. First one is his birth, the second one is his life, the third is his first great poem, and the last one is his death. And after that, I will go to the poem. William Butler Yeats, he was born in 13 June 1865 in Dublin, Ireland, and he died in France on 28 January 1939 at the age of 73. His life, the second point, his life, he was one of the famous literature in the 20th century, and he was a common literary for each the Irish and the British institutions. He served as a member in the Irish Senate for 2 terms, and he revived the Irish literature along with Lady Gregory, and with others. He created the Abbey Theatre, which he served in it as a chairman for in his first years. In 1923, he received the Nobel Prize in Literature as the first Irish. And the third point is his first great poem, which was the Island of Status, a really great work of fiction. Yeats hoped that he can include it to his collection, to his first collection, but unfortunately it was considered too long, and it was actually never republished in his lifetime. After Yeats death many years, there is a man called Quinks. He wrote the poem in a full form and published it for the first time in 2014. And the fourth point is his death. Yeats died in 28 January 1939 in France. Yeats and his friend George often discussed his death and how he wanted to bury it quickly in France. And George tell us about his actual words, that he said, "If I die, bury me up there, and then in years' time, when the newspaper have forgotten me, dig me up and plant me in Selbu." After 7 years of his death, his body was moved to Selbu. In the Irish Nafal. And now let's go to the boy, which is an Irish airman foresees his death. I know that I shall meet my fate somewhere among the clouds above. The speaker here starts with certainty that he will meet his destiny. And by fate in the boy, he means death, that he knows that he will die. And somewhere among the clouds above, the speaker is an air fighter, and he said clouds above because he was on the ground when he said that. If he was on the sky already, he would say the clouds around me. Anyway, many of people died in that war, and planes was not safe like today. Those that I fight, I do not hate. Those that I guard, I do not love. The speaker here tell us that the soldiers were forced to fight and defend their country. And he doesn't want to fight those because he don't hate them, and he don't want to guard his countrymen because he doesn't love them. My country is Kiltertan cross, my countrymen Kiltertan's poor. The speaker here say my country twice, which means that he feels Irish. No likely end could bring them loss or leave them happier than before. The speaker says that this war is pointless and it can never make the people of Kurdistan happier than before, and it can't make them lose anything. And the war is just pointless, and there is no point of it. There will be just the people of Kurdistan, they will be just like they were before. Nor law, nor duty bade me fight, nor public men, nor cheering crowds. Basically, there is no reason for him to go to the war, to join the army. In this case, to join the air, to join the force. The law didn't make him go, and the public men didn't make him, and also the cheering crowds didn't make him go. So what made him go to the fighting and to the war? This is what we're going to know in the next lines. A lonely embers of delight drove to this timbrot in the clouds. Now it is clear for us that the thing that made him fight was just an impulse of delight. That impulse drove him to go to the war, and that if, in other words, this impulse forced the airman to involve them in this war. The next lines, I balanced all, brought all to mind, the years to come seemed waste of breath. After all, the speaker's decision wasn't good after all, that he shouldn't go to this war and join them and like that. He balanced all and brought all to mind, which is to say, thought everything and thought everything through. Years to come seemed waste of breath. He decided that the years was just pointless, and his life would be just pointless. The last lines, waste of breath, the years behind, in balance with this life, this death. The hopeless tone continues in the speaker. And the speaker says, years behind was also waste of breath. He just think that all these years was just waste of breath, and pointless. But actually, as can you see, the future and the past seem like waste of breath when compared. As can you see, actually it wasn't pointless, but when you compared it to something, it is pointless and there is no point of it. This is my presentation, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
Really amazing, and you have to be cheerful.
Thank you.
Good. Sit down.